Hi, welcome back. Okay, so this is some rule which I don't want you to forget. Please make sure that you, if you quote verbatim, the reader knows that you are quoting verbatim. I cannot emphasize the importance of this rule. Please remember, anytime you are caught not doing this, it is academic suicide. You should not do. Okay, lots of people's reputation takes a nosedive simply because of some silly mistake of this type. Please don't do it ever, and make sure that you tell your students that they are not supposed to do it ever. So let's move on to the next. So this is again a tutorial. Okay, I want you to read through this tutorial, and then I have a couple of questions. At the end, we will discuss that. Okay. So the question is this written well? So if you have finished reading this page, you raise your hand, so I'll go to the next page. This is about 4 pages long, okay? So I should know when to move to the next page. So the equations are missing. I'm sorry about that. I did write them, but it's messed up. So there is an equation, h squared by 4 pi e squared something is equal to, okay? So now I'm going to take a short poll. The poll is, we can do it in 2 ways. Either we take a poll about whether it is well written or not well written, and then from each people will tell why they think it is well written or not well written. Or we can go row wise, one person per column, standing up and saying whether it is well written or not well written and why. So if Shobhan gives you the mic, or you can volunteer, either way it works. If nobody volunteers, he will give randomly to somebody. I want you to stand up and say whether you think this is a well-written passage or not, and B, why. Okay, it's not sufficient just to say this is not well-written. You have to tell me why you think it is not well-written. And it's not sufficient to say that it's great writing. You have to tell me why it is great in your opinion.
Like in the first paragraph itself, more of expectations are there from the reader's point of view. We think of items, we have a clear picture. So it's expected from the readers that they have this imagination. So I think that...
That is the wrong expectation to have?
According to me.
Okay. So you think it is not good writing because the expectation was wrong. Right? I mean, yes. I'm just paraphrasing. I'm okay with the answer. Okay.
Yeah, I think.
Okay. Very good.
Sir, as I open, sir, as far as the technical communication is concerned, some of the words must be concrete, which should give the specific idea. But in this paragraph, some of the concrete words are missing.
Examples?
For example, here it is mentioned that when we think of atoms, we have a clear picture of in our minds. Then it is mentioned a central nucleus and a swarm of electrons surrounding it. Means there are so many orbits and where the electron moves, so it must be clarified. As far as the equation is concerned, some of things are really missing, I think so.
The equation is missing, but that is because of
no,
my typing.
No, not the equation, but whatever the things are needed for that, I think so. The concreteness is not there.
Because of words like swarming being used.
Yeah, it's a colloquial words many a times have been used.
Okay.
My opinion is exactly contrary to him. When he uses the words swarm of electrons and all, a person like me who does not belong to the science background, the picture is because I'm not regularly thinking of atoms and the nucleus and all. So when I read this, I am suddenly, you know, attuned to what is going to follow. So I think this was a very good beginning because it encouraged me to read the second one also and the third also. And then so slightly when it comes to more technical thing, for a distance, you know, I'm going to, you know, keep up with what the person is trying to say.
According to me, it's well written because in the beginning it sets up the background. In the end of the, they are asking, the gist of it is trying to establish a relation between the stars and the atom. How the stars exactly behave, or how they are situated and pattern of them, and how they are, that is similar to our atoms. So he set a background, and he is creating, giving us certain set of equations, the equations which rule the micro level of, you know, I mean, atoms, and then he's relating it to the macro level of energy. I feel it's a good article.
Okay.
Sir, some pictures may be added with this writing so that everyone gets a clear idea of what he is giving as atom.
Okay. So, but as writing, is it okay or you think it is lacking?
It is
because
okay.
There are no
it is
pictures?
Okay. But some pictorial representation is necessary.
Necessary. Okay.
This particular passage is very easy to understand.
Hmm.
In that point of view, it is okay.
Hmm.
But in the last paragraph, the word I, it may be avoided.
A word I should be avoided.
It is my thinking in that particular.
I see. Why you think why I should be avoided?
Can I see the last?
Yeah.
I don't think the word I is must in this particular place.
Okay. We'll come back to this. Okay.
I find it it's a good writing. The reason is sentence is long. They used many colons and semicolons and use of that and making a sentence. I think it is easy to understand what they are telling.
Okay, one last opinion if somebody wants to give. Yes, ma'am, there.
Sir, the piece of writing, where it concerns technical writing, I think it needs to be very clear and understood by a lay person. So as a communication skills person, when I read it, I can still understand a technical piece of writing. So there's a lot of clarity in what has been written. So that's how I look at it as an okay kind of a writing.
Okay. So thank you for pitching in. Somebody else will pitch in next time. So next exercise, you get the chance. Okay. There are more exercises. We'll come back to it. So so I said that first is content. Okay. Are we okay with the content? Yes. So there is something about atoms, and then from there to stars, there is a connection. Connection is brought out, and being a technical piece, it is also brought out in a very quantitative manner. I mean, two equations and it is brought out. So content is okay. Clarity is there. It's very clear what he's trying to do. And in terms of style and voice, so here is where I want you to appreciate that it is a personal thing. Somebody might feel that swarming is not the right word. Somebody might feel that that is the right word. That depends on the background, the attitude, on the person. And somebody wants pictures. Somebody doesn't want to say I. And this brings us to a most important point, which we will discuss slightly later, that any piece will be considered as good or bad depending on the context in which it is written. Okay. Now, anybody guessed who the writer is? Budding research scholar, somebody said for Frank? Okay. Yes?
Maybe a budding research scholar.
Budding research scholar. Okay. Somebody else had any opinion?
Because when you look into the text, you know, the first sentence can be restructured very properly. Rather than we now ask, it may be asked either we can understand. Because there is no punctuation mark at the end of the sentence. Right? Another one. Rather than using active voice, like in this lecture, I shall attempt to show that. In this lecture, it is attempt to show that. Because
okay,
impersonal passive voice sounds more better.
Why? That's what I'm
because
trying
it is,
to.
Because it is understood that it is attempted by the writer. So not necessarily saying every time I.
So that's what I'm telling. That is not necessary. You can say, this is what I believe.
Because it is generally felt that in technical communication, we should give more importance on the action rather than the doer of action.
It's not
it
true.
It is clearly understood that it is done by I or somebody else.
It's not
so
true.
Unless it is warranted, that is not necessary to repeat the pronouns being subjective.
It is not
what
true.
I mean. Yes,
that
sir.
Is why I gave the example of Raman and Einstein. We have been taught that in technical communication, as far as possible, you have to use passive voice. It's not necessary. and this rule is old. More modern writing does not insist that there should be passive voice, and it also sounds very archaic and old fashioned if people use passive voice. The current trend is to use more active voice, and that brings us to the question, who is the author of this passage? This is Subramanian Chandrasekhar.
It sounds very informal, sir. The last one sounds very informal.
But that is okay. No, that's what I'm trying to tell you. It depends on the context. When it comes to style and voice, whether it is informal or formal depends on where, in what context it is written. So you cannot judge that without knowing the context. Now, the context in which this is written is that this is the Nobel Prize lecture of S. Chandrasekhar. Now, Chandrasekhar is taking pains to explain, because Nobel lecture will not only have physicists but from other chemistry, biology, everybody.
I thought it was very formal audience.
No, that's okay. No, that's okay. No. This is not a trick question. I'm just telling you that when you look at a specific piece of article, the first question you have to ask. So content and clarity, everybody can make up their minds. More or less people will converge. Now, style and voice, which is more difficult, you cannot make up your mind unless you know in what context, for which audience it was delivered. So content and clarity wins. But when it comes to style and voice, it is very difficult to know unless the context is said, which also tells you that the same information, you cannot put it in the same way everywhere. The pictures are missing because he is giving a lecture. And somebody made the observation about the commas, colons, everything. They are there because he is reading out his Nobel Prize lecture. Okay? So, I believe that this is a very good piece of writing, given the audience, given what he is trying to communicate and the way he communicates. Of course, there would be problems. Chandrasekhar cannot write this in a journal article. There are overall stylistic things which I agree with Chandrasekhar. I also believe that if there are personal pronouns, you should use them. Okay. Just because, you know, it will be attempted to show does not mean who is going to show. Anyway, he is only is going to show. He might as well accept that I will attempt to show. Okay. So that is a stylistic thing. There I am not expecting you to agree with me. You are welcome if you think that no, it should still be passive voice. But if some of you feel active voice sounds good, you should not hesitate to use it, because that is not wrong. I have shown you till now three examples, all three Nobel laureates using I before they became Nobel laureates. I mean, you can always say, oh, he's a Nobel laureate, he can say, but Raman did not have a Nobel Prize, okay, when he wrote that, nor did Einstein, and in this case, of course, he has become a Nobel laureate, so you can say that he is using, but this is okay to use, okay, very good. So we are able to make judgments on writing, but the judgment should go in that order. Content, clarity, style and voice is the most subjective, and it also depends on other factors. Unless you know all the factors, it's very difficult to judge. I didn't give you the context. The next one, I'm going to give you the context. This is written in a scientific journal. So this is his Nobel Prize lecture. Please go and read Chandrasekhar's Nobel Prize lecture. It's very beautiful. Chandrasekhar is well known for his writings, technical and non-technical. He is a good model to follow in terms of writing. So this is a good piece of writing. Now, the other one, the next passage that I'm going to show you, it is written in a scientific journal. It was published in a scientific journal, let me put it that way. Okay? So that is the context. Now I want you to analyze, again, in terms of content, clarity, style and voice. Okay, we are going to read through. Please raise your hands if you have read the passage so that I can move to the next page. There are 2-3 pages, and this time the comments will come first from here and there, and then it will move, right? Unless I see 90% of hands, I can't move.
Okay. So regarding this, if it is taken from an article, it has been copied, taken and pasted, or I want just to clarify it because just some punctuation errors. Plus, when you go to the second, if you see the second last line, without magnification, deep studies and research. Not so. Same slide.
Same page. Huh.
The last line without magnification, deep studies and research. When we say deep studies and we can't say research, we can say researchers are impossible. And then we go for again. I could understand the tenor, the voice. This technique is applied in physics, astronomy, biology, medicine, architecture, particle physics, genetics, microbiology, and in chemistry. It means the authors are from the domain of chemistry.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Maybe.
Okay.
Yeah. Then for a second slide, the second line in brief, there should be a pass, the comma. An impossible proposition was proved as possible. And this is a problematic problem where mathematics always deals with problems. It is not problematic. So that, which means that we need much more clarity in that.
So clarity is lacking?
In that area.
Content is okay?
Content is okay.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. We'll come third. There is somebody else.
Actually, in the previous thing which we saw, like, the words were like literature-oriented words to give stylistic to the thing was used, but in this we don't find anything of such.
Okay.
It is like a journal article, like right. We feel. Like.
So, but how about content and clarity? Are you okay with the content and are you okay with the clarity?
It's somewhat confusing, like this.
Somewhat confusing.
Second
okay.
passage.
So the clarity is not that great. How about content?
Yeah, that I felt it was good. For the first page, it was okay, passage.
Okay.
The second one, like, confusing, I feel.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I feel it's a good piece of writing.
Okay.
For the same reason, the content is good, easily understood by a layperson like me.
Okay.
I absolutely have no exposure to scientific journals. I'm a humanities background.
Okay.
And I perfectly understood the content.
Okay.
It's absolutely clear as to what was the problem, where did it start, and you know what the future has, the future studies. So as you mentioned a little early, it's important to point out where things will be taken, others should be able to use, and that has become very clear. And as far as the style is concerned, it is a little less personal than the previous one, but still I liked it and I appreciate. So on the whole, it's a good piece of writing.
Okay, very good. Yes, there.
So regarding with the this is almost good, sir.
Okay.
The author tried to transfer his imagination with the other people like that. And clarity, it is also a little bit good. But there is a change in style and voice.
Mm.
So voice is a passive voice. Mm. And it is not a first-person narration.
Mm.
And with that, we feel some kind of... that is the only reason we can... say that it is a little bit confused, but everything is good.
Okay.
Usage of words, again, it is his own style, that is writer's style. Example, this is a problematic problem, right? So in such a case, that adjective used as problematic, there is no wrong in it. But here the author tried to, what's called, impose his, her bombastic method of using words that makes something odd in understanding the information, that's all. So regarding with the content, clarity, everything is good. Style and voice is different from the previous examples which we have seen. This passive voice and the usage of words is little bit different.
Okay. Yeah, behind.
See, sir, according to all the context that what you said, that the criteria to identify whether it is good writing or not, this is really nice piece of writing. It's a very clear and precise one. Anybody can understand. In comparison to previous text, I understood it in one reading. For that, I need to go back to the same sentences again and again. But here, I need not to do that. The information is very clear. The sentences are precise and easy to understand. Regarding style, what I mean to say that style varies from person to person, as you stated earlier. So when we talk about technical communication, we need to convey the message exactly instead of paying much attention on the style. So I feel that anybody can read it and anybody can understand it, and that is the purpose of communication.
Sir, here it's starting with computer magnification is a universal computer phenomenon.
Right.
And immediately he is going to, this technique is applied in these are the different areas, right. And maybe in that, say, it's given physics, again, the later particle physics, right. Branch of that, right. They're mentioning.
Right.
And when we go to the next slide, there, again, he's coming to the point where the first time in the history, and initially he was telling the universal, and then maybe then he's telling it is applied in so many areas and all, and maybe it's a little confusing what I feel when I go to the content of this.
Okay.
Sir, I just want to ask one thing, whether it is in passages for the from the monograph or it is a passage from the paper.
This is from a paper?
Paper.
This is the last paragraph of the paper?
Okay. If it is a paper, then I don't think that such kind of writing is required, because if he has done such a good research, he should be in that should be in part of monograph in spite of research paper. Because he has mentioned that for a nearly 4300 years old parallel postulate problem.
Right.
So if it is a that kind of research label, it should be in part of monograph, not a research paper.
Okay. So we'll come back and discuss this there.
Sir, I feel it is not that clear, or it's self-contradictory at times. First of all, when it is said that it is universal, there was no need to mention all the branches of science, because the term universal itself is comprehensive. And in the second slide again, problematic problem, possibly he is intending to say complex or something. So he's overemphasizing and things like that. So overall, I feel that it's not a very good piece of writing.
Okay. Very good. So this is a difference. I don't know if you come from humanities background, ma'am. Great results are published only in monographs. It's not the norm in science. In science, great results are published in maximum impact journals. Goes to Science or Nature or ACS or IEEE. So the way things proceed is that open problems are first solved in the open literature. And then more people criticize or build on it or accept. And if it becomes acceptable to a specific community, then it becomes a monograph. Then if it becomes acceptable across different parts of the same community, then it becomes a textbook material. So most of the great textbook materials are published in journals first. Okay? So it's not necessary that it has to be a monograph. But in humanities, this is not so. Humanities people write monographs in a particular area, or at least I understand that is the norm, and the journal articles are very far and few in between, and they are also like addresses or asking some questions and that sort of stuff. So they will write lots of that, but when actually comes to substantial amount, it will become a monograph. Okay. I cheated a little bit, because even though this was published in a journal, this is not really well written, and two people picked it up, but I think they picked it up because they probably have some background in computer science or something. So this is the note that was published by the journal. It has no scientific content. It was accepted because of an administrative error. Okay. I apologize for putting this example, but I want you to think, I mean, this is where I said we have to make mistakes. Then we have to learn why the mistakes, and that is when learning happens. That is the reason why I introduced. Both my passages are chosen in such a way to. So the point that I want to emphasize is that science, technical writing, or humanities, anything that is done at an academic level actually requires lots of effort. Communication has to happen with as little effort as possible. But everything that looks clear is not great science communication, because some things are harder. To understand stars starting from atoms is a hard problem, right? In terms of content that is available, that is really extraordinary amount of content. I don't think, however great the person who is telling is and however great we are, we will be able to read it in one reading.
Right.
Yes, ma'am.
Without reading the article.
Right. 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 Right.
Now from that only we cannot make out that it has been
You had no way of knowing. That is why I apologized. You had no way of knowing. But I wanted to show you that even if I give you the context, that yes, it was published in a journal, I can show you so many articles which were not retracted, which had equally, you know, minimal content. Again, I am showing this to you because I have gone through this problem. You go to the new journals used to be put up on Thursday afternoons, you go to the library, there are 25 different articles. You read them. You think that every problem in the world has been solved by all these people. You just don't know what else there to, for you to do. And when I was in my third year of research, something worse happened. There was a paper which had the same title as my research problem. I was so upset, so dejected, that I did not want to look at the paper for fear of all my work going down the drain. Somebody has already published. Then my seniors told me that, no, that is not always possible. Even if it is the same problem, why do you think that the person has solved the same way? Maybe something you can salvage out of your work. So let's go take a look at it. We went through, it was slightly different, and it was addressing a different problem in the same material. I was okay. Then I came to my advisor and said, you know, Abhi, people are publishing in this, I think we should publish fast. And he said, Guru, this is the first thing you have to learn. We are not in the business to be publishing first. We are in the business to understand. If we understand well, then we go tell people that this is what we understand. That is how we build our reputation. So this is very, very important, because first time if you go read, people tend to think. Now, first people tend to think that whatever is written is anyway great. Right? How do you challenge somebody? Give it to me in writing. Okay. So somebody is willing to put it in black and white in print, people tend to think that it is always true. On top of it, it is published in a journal. This is not like something that I printed and, you know, sent it to people. Which means there was an editor for the journal who has read this. Then there were reviewers who have read this. They have accepted. So you tend to think that there must be some truth in it. And this can happen at all levels. I'm not saying that this happens only at this level. This can happen at all levels. Of course, there are markers to indicate that this is not that well written, which was picked up by few people. Anything that makes grandiose claims, like everything is universal and I have solved problems which is 4,300 years old and things like that, please be careful. Okay? Don't accept anything by authority. Don't accept anything because somebody else says that this is how we have done. And if you see claims like that, I think it is natural for you to be skeptical as scientists, and you should, in fact, you should take the exact opposite approach to the written word. You should think that everything that is written is false. Unless it is proved otherwise, who will do the proof? You will do the proof. You will go through and you will make up your mind whether you accept it or not. So, I mean, in terms of English also, there were some problems like some people pointed out. And on top of it, I think some sentences were also taken from elsewhere. That is why there is a change in language that you perceive, the way it is said. So these things are really hard. I mean, all that I'm saying is that it's really difficult to judge good writing, especially technical writing. Because A, we want it to be very clear, and B, we know that subject matter is so complex that it is not easy to make it that clear. So there is a personal decision you have to make. Some things can be very clear, but they might be trivial. Does that make it good to technical writing? So these are harder questions to ask and answer. So the purpose of these two exercises is for you to be alert, pay attention, and you need to develop a knack to identify the wheat from the chaff. That takes a long time. And I'm not claiming that I have achieved that either. Even now I have sometimes problems. And the problem is worse because somebody sends a paper to me for review. Now I need to make up my mind whether this is really worth publishing or not worth publishing. It's not exactly in my area of research. Occasionally you get papers exactly in my area of research where I can just look at it, I can make up my mind. They are from nearby areas. Now, do I accept it? Then somebody else asks, so who is this stupid referee who accepted this? Do I reject it? In which case the authors write to the editor saying that who is this stupid reviewer who rejected it, and here are our arguments as to why he is wrong. Right? Every time you write a review report, you are sticking your neck out and you are saying this is what I believe. The only way you can do it with minimal damage to yourself is by being factual and detailed. That is the only way you are going to save yourself. You can say, yes, they might be right, but here are my reasons. Let them answer that, and if it is okay, then the editor can take a call, right? And even when you make it accept, somebody comes and asks why, you can give, this is the reason why I thought this is okay. So that judgment is still difficult for me, and it is difficult for most of us, but I think the attempt should be made, and you have to make it a lot more before you will be able to probably, you know, at one go look at something and say whether it is okay or not okay. So I am going to now go into some details of some tricks and things like that that I want to discuss with you, some things that work, something that doesn't work, so that you can also think about in your own writing process how to incorporate some of them, how to look at some of them, and things like that. Okay. So the first one, technical writing, like I said, is to communicate concepts and help others take off from where you leave. But there is also one more reason why you write technical stuff. That is what economists call as the signaling. Now, signaling is very important because, for example, sometimes companies come and pay lots of money to students who are graduating from our college. Are they giving all that money because of what we are teaching the students? I like to think so, but I know that that is not the case. Companies are looking for some signals. What are the signals? The first signal is, this kid has cleared JEE. So analytical skills must be good, because unless you have some amount of analytical skill, you can't clear. Second thing is, the person has this much of grade point average, because the courses are harder or perceived to be harder. Whether they are harder or not is a different discussion altogether. This person has managed means he or she knows how to split time and do things, and then the resume has lots of other activities, so the person must have done really good time management. So for the company, what is needed are good analytical skills and good time management skills, so we hire. So in this case, the degree from such and such institution is just of signal value. They are not going to look at, oh, did you do this particular course? What is it that they taught? That is the core company's job. And nobody wants to go join core companies, or core companies don't come and take students from us. Now, this signaling business, so things like this is known as signaling. For example, buying a huge BMW or Volkswagen, whatever car, is a signaling. It tells other people that you can afford this kind of money, right? You wearing some particular type of shoes, carrying a particular kind of handbag, right? Or carrying iPhone, for example, or Mac computers, for example. They are all considered as signals. Now, every community will have its own signals, right? Gandhi wears only that type of dress because that is a type of signal that he is trying to send people. The others don't do. Rajagopalachari doesn't do, Nehru doesn't do, Subhash Bose doesn't do, Ambedkar doesn't do. But they are all also wearing their own kind of dress, and they are signaling their own constituents. Okay? In academic writing, the signaling happens through references. In humanities, it happens in the footnotes. In most of scientific writing, it happens in the references. This is what I said. If you send a project proposal, if, for example, a project proposal comes to me, in 5 minutes I have to decide whether these people are really serious or not. First thing I look at is the references. Do they have the key references referred to or not? If they have not, then I know that they haven't done that 15 days of job to figure out which are the important papers in the area. Now, already I have made up my mind through the signals about what kind of proposal it's going to be. I might be wrong. I am not saying that I am right. But it is a fact of life that if I have so many things to do, And if I have to evaluate the project proposal in one afternoon, I would like to be that reviewer who spends 1 week, and occasionally you do spend 1 week. Okay, I have recently got a paper, I couldn't make the head or tail out of it. I spent 3 days trying to derive everything. Finally, I figured that the authors have made some particular error in particular step. The rest of the math is correct. You can't refuse, and otherwise they'll think that you don't know any math. So sometimes you do put that kind of effort, but you cannot bank on that kind of effort being put by the reviewer all the time. I don't put that kind of effort all the time. And it will be so for you too. I mean, if you get 15 proposals to evaluate, you will also do that, right? If you have a class of 30 students and you give an assignment, how carefully are you going to read all 30? Okay. So people have problems with time management. One way to indicate to them that you are serious about what you are doing is by doing this signaling. And the signaling is done primarily to show what is the type of scholarship you have. And it is also important for another reason. Most of the technical writing that you do, except for paper writing, is reviewed by others, not just for its content, but also for what it tells about your scholarship. I write a thesis, I get a degree. I get a degree not for the thesis. I get a degree because people think that he can be an independent researcher in this area, which means they want to know not just what is there in the thesis, whether I have solved a big problem or that has lots of impact or not. If that is there, that is bonus. But most of the times people are trying to see, did he take a problem? Did he do a thorough analysis? Did he look at the literature? Does he know everything that is there to know about this problem? And then, okay, if you have made some nominal progress or not, then based on that you get a degree. Annual progress seminar reports, which are essential for us. Every year PhD students have to write a report for what they have done in the past 1 year and what they are planning to do in the next 1 year. There people evaluate based on what the scholarship of the person is. The subject matter experts go through and try to decide whether he knows the basic things in the area or not. Your BTech presentations, your seminar courses. Everywhere when you are evaluating students, you are making evaluation not just about the material. There it is not just content, clarity and style and voice. On top of it, how much you know in the area is also to be communicated. That scholarship aspect, it's a bonus. That is not the primary aim of the technical communication. But when you are doing things like this, writing thesis reports, writing project proposals, trying to convince others. It might be a white paper on some particular area, you are advising the government that this is what their policy should be. All that will depend on what kind of respect they give you. Based on that, you know, if I tell you that already this is S. Chandrasekhar's Nobel Prize lecture, would you have looked at that passage differently? I'm sure some of us would have. Okay. Would I, if I had told you already that this is a retracted paper, you would have looked at this information differently. So there is some signaling, and that signaling is part of, this is why it is not objective all the time. It can never be objective. Okay, it's always subjective. The only thing is how much I know or how much I don't know, that is what influences what I'm doing. So, and how do you show your scholarship in references? First is, every community thinks that these are the standard things that everybody should know or standard papers everybody should have read. You should have read those papers and you should show that you have read those papers by putting them in your reference. And second thing is, writing references in proper format is a very, very time consuming and painful job. Okay, there is lots of drudgery associated with that. But just because you have put that effort to do that, is what tells people that you are serious about what you are doing. Okay. There are papers which get rejected because references are not in proper format. It's the worst kind of review that you can get. The authors are not serious. It's all very sloppy work. Even the references are not in proper order. Right? That is that low. Even though writing a proper reference would take for about several hours for you, if you use good software like tech or something, which some of it will be discussed, I suppose. Without that, it is a nightmare. But that is what tells people as to how serious you are about what you are doing. Okay? This is very, very important, and you should pay lots of attention to it. And none of your technical writing should go out from your desk or from your email account without making sure that it is done properly and perfectly. The time that you spend is worth, because this is the signal. I don't know, every subject area might have similar things. Metallurgists, for example, there is lots of drudgery we put our students to make some samples. You know, grind it, polish it, and cut it, and do this, do that. All that 6 hours for what? Finally, it is not a skill, and most of them will not even use the skill. But this is part of the profession. If you are going to do that, you have to go through this. Okay. Reference is that part of drudgery part which separates people who are serious about technical writing from people who are not serious about technical writing. So, because it signals that aspect, you should pay lots of attention to references. So you should spruce them up and you should do it properly. I will show you some common mistakes that people make. So there are two different ways of writing things. All of you must be asking your students to write reports sometimes. What do? They write the full report and show it to you? Or they make the important points and show it to you? Or they make an outline and show it to you, and then they write, and as they are writing, you are fleshing it out? What is the methodology that you use? So they have to need to submit an outline and then, yeah. So this is a common practice. Again, this practice is against what I told you about technical writing. This practice works well if you think that technical writing is whatever is already there in your mind, you put it down. So you write your outline, you show it to me, and then it is through. I also used to have difficulties. Okay, advisor asks for an outline, but things are not clear to me. And then I put something and he is upset because, you know, most important thing is missing, and why is this coming after this, why is that not being discussed here? So there is lots of difficulty. So even if your colleague or advisor wants you to give an outline kind of things, I find it very hard to write. Because like I said, I don't believe that writing process is something where everything is clear to me, then I am putting the outline on paper. It doesn't happen to me. So I believe in the other way of writing. The other way of writing is you take a piece of paper or you open a new file in your computer, write everything that comes to your mind. Okay? And I think you should also train your students to do that. If you believe in this form of writing and if it works for you, then it is better for students also to get trained to do that. Okay? Previously used to do, I mean, they used to make index cards and, you know, arrange index cards. Some of you might have done MPhil or something where they teach these research methodologies, as they are called. Okay. So sometimes it is very helpful for me if I write all the information, because A, it avoids the so-called writer's block. Right? I sit in front of the computer, I don't know how to start, I don't know how to organize, I don't know where to end. Now, writing everything takes that problem away. Whatever comes to my mind, I can write. I can write about the experiment, suddenly I can write about the results and discussion, suddenly I can write about what the literature says, what so-and-so claimed, whether we are agreeing or not agreeing, or in some places we seem to be agreeing with so-and-so, some other places we are agreeing with so-and-so. Write everything down. After you write everything down, you start looking for a story. This is another thing which I didn't realize. You know, I used to read papers. The papers start beautifully. I used to start from the beginning and read till the end. So it says this is the title, then the abstract says this is a big problem and this is what people were trying to do and we have decided to solve it and we have solved it. And the introduction says so and so started in 50 looking at this, 60 they did this, 70 they did this, even in 80 this problem didn't go away. And these are the typical methodologies, and so we decided that we should look at it this way and solve this, and of course we have solved it, and then there is an experiment and then there is result discussion which proves conclusively that this is what is done, and conclusion neatly summarizes. And I always used to think that these guys are too smart, right? I go to the lab, I write a program, I want to solve some problem, I end up solving some other problem. Then I realized that everybody is doing the same thing except that they are presenting it different. So if you want to do the presentation, so this again I have learned from my advisor, the first thing that you write is your experiments or your methodology section. Because that anyway somebody, whoever is going to read last. Very few people are going to read. And anyway, you will be very confident because that is what you have been doing for the past 10 years anyway. So you are quite comfortable writing that part. So write it. Then, in the results and discussion part is where actually technical writing helps you clarify your thinking. Okay, this is the experiment. This is what I am claiming. Maybe there is an objection that this is happening. Oh, I haven't done that control experiment to prove that this is not happening. I'll go do that experiment and put. So from my point of view, if you want to write a paper based on your work, you should be starting it from day one. In your notebook, you should write why you are doing the experiment, what your expectations are, how it will solve your problem. And you should keep updating it. And that is what will become finally some results and discussion session. Then after results and discussion, you should write your conclusion. After you write your conclusion, then you have to now go back and write the introduction so that the question that you are going to ask, this is going to be the answer. This is what Sundar also pointed out the other day, that we always want to summarize by asking what is the question, what is the answer. So find the answer first, then you can find the corresponding question and you can put it there. And then you should write the abstract last, because this is the order in which people will read. First they will look at the title, they will decide to read the paper or not. Then they will go read the abstract. If it was written after everything became clearer to you, it will carry that clarity. Then if they are more interested, they will go read the conclusions, which is more detailed. If they are convinced about the conclusion, they will come and look at the introduction to see in what setting what you are doing. Rarely, maybe occasionally, few people will try to reproduce your work because they want to go beyond what you have done. They are the only ones who are going to read your experiments or methodology section. Please remember, that does not mean that you will write your methodology section sloppily, because that goes against my scientific communication concept. I have written this paper, of the 1,000 people who are going to see, finally 2 people are going to read that section, and if I don't respect those 2, what kind of communicator am I? Okay, so that also should be written up to the standard. There is no let up on that. But if you write in this order, it becomes easier for you to satisfy everybody. And your paper will also have this story. Okay, so finally the aim is to tell a story. Most of the times what I am trying to indicate is that the story is not clear upfront. So please take an approach where you can make it look like a story. But that will come much later, so there is lots of background effort that goes in. That effort for me generally goes in by writing like this. I write everything that comes to my mind and then I try to see if there is one story that I can build. And once I decide that this is the story, then everything is aligned towards that. Of course, the most difficult part is that you have written that beautiful one paragraph about some problem that is not fitting in the story. Our tendency is to stick it in somewhere. Okay, I don't know if you have heard this upanyas or whatever, the traditional storytelling. It starts with one and then there is a story inside the story, then there is a story inside the story, and by the time you come back to the original story, you have forgotten what the story is about. So we tend to do technical writing also like that, and that actually affects us. In the technical writing community, that is not how they look at. They want one story. If there is another story that is branching off from there, maximum you do is that, okay, there is also this problem, we will publish it elsewhere. Because that is the second story you are going to write for another journal. That this is not the place for that. Even in thesis, you should be ruthless when it comes to editing. If it is not fitting in your scheme of things, push it to an appendix. At that point, just make a note that there is also this problem, go to the appendix to look at the details. But all through, each technical document should have one focus, one question, one answer. And that is what makes the maximum impact in terms of the story that you are telling. Okay? So I always found that whether you write top down or bottom up depends on your philosophy of writing, whether you believe everything should be in place before you start writing, or you start writing because things will become clearer to you. And if you believe in the second one, then you should use this approach because that is helpful. But if you are taking the other approach, then you have to write the sections, section subsections, within subsections, paragraphs, and each one of those paragraph one sentences will become the either the topical sentence in that paragraph or the conclusion sentence in that paragraph. Okay, so we will also discuss, I will show you an example. So paragraphs is also very important. Each paragraph actually talks about a different idea. So they are connected things. So each paragraph should either start with what the point you are going to make or should end with what is the point that you have made, and it should move on. Okay. Even in email communication, this is very, very important. Each idea should have a different paragraph. Those are the easy emails for you to read, and for you also, you know, humans take information in bunches. So paragraphs actually help you do that. I'll show you a classic example of this kind of paragraph building that is done to communicate concepts. So this is the approach that is taken if you are writing top down, but write everything and then move around passages. In these days with editors, it's very easy. You can cut whole passages, put it there, modify, move some passage, bring it back later. You know, my advisor says, no, this is irrelevant. If I delete that, and tomorrow he says, no, I think there is a place for this, so bring it back, okay? I don't want to delete permanently. Put it somewhere else and bring it back if he or she wants it back, okay? So this works very nicely. So this is a trick that you can try. And this is the writing order. What you did should be first. What you got should be next. What you think and why should be the third. And why what you have done is of importance is the next. Abstract should be last.
Top down and the bottom up approach. Sometimes we tend to mix up both the things together.
Please do.
While editing and while checking.
Please do. Yeah. So you need to find out how much of top down works, how much of bottom up works for you. Okay. For example, like I said, even sometimes, even though I tend to think that I write the bottom up approach, sometimes it is very clear to me. The student has shown a particular result. Then I know that this is what the crux of this paper is, and this is going to go into this journal. They will be interested in it because of this reason. So this is the background we need to put. This is a question we have to ask. This is the answer we have to. So it is clear in my mind, at least sometimes. So it's not black and white. It's not like people who write top down never do bottom up, or those do bottom up never do. So even those who come up with, for example, the top down approach, some sections they might have this exercise done already, and then they come up and then they give. That is why I said, even if you demand your students that they do the top down approach, that they give you an outline before they give you the full report, tell them that it is okay for them to play around with it, mess with it, and then come up with it. Okay? And whatever works, to whatever extent it works. For example, if I am writing some lecture notes, most of the times I go top down. I know what topics have to be covered, in what order they have to be covered, and in each topic what has to be discussed, what questions, what tutorial problems, what in-class tutorial, everything I know. So then I go just fill in the details. Okay? So it can happen. And this is the last point you have to remember. You always want to tell a story. But to tell a story, you should know the full story. Okay? The story cannot change as you are telling it. Because of which is why you write the abstract, which is the full story, as the last thing. Okay? So this approach helps a lot, and it makes your writing much better. The only disadvantage I found is that we all fall in love with what we write. Okay? I used to hate my advisor because I wrote that beautiful 4 pages, which he pushed to the abstract appendix. But that is how it is. I mean, he said it doesn't fit in this narrative, so it has no place here. You have to be ruthless. And professional writers will tell you that the editors who do it for them are the reason why these books are so great. There is somebody who is paid to do this job, whose job is to cut all the unnecessary things and make the book as sleek and impactful as possible. And there are reviewers sometimes, you know, Hindu book review, if you read, a good editor could have done a much better job cutting 50 pages or something like that, they would comment. Okay? So it's very difficult to be a ruthless editor with your own writing. That is where your peers and your colleagues and your superiors come into play. But as much as possible, you should not hesitate to cut down things which are not fitting with your narrative. This is just a technique. I am not saying that that 4 pages that I put in appendix is not great, or nor did my advisor indicate that that is not great. All that he said is, in this context, that is irrelevant. Okay. So those judgments you have to make, and if you see some of the good papers, you will see that they follow these tricks. That is why it becomes good writing. Now, what is telling a story? You have to tell what is expected, and you have to tell whether the expectation is met or not. Sometimes it makes an interesting story if you make them expect something and the expectation is not met. Okay, a trick which I played with you when I gave the tutorial. I said this is a journal article. Okay, so you make you expect something, then I tell you something. So that is very, very impactful, because then you will remember this nasty trick that I did to you for longer. Then if I said already that it's a retracted paper, you will think, I can understand why this is bad and we are done. Okay, it's not how it is done. So always tell. And sometimes I have also seen people, I mean, this I find with more, starting point researchers and students. They will come, they will make a presentation. They will tell you, I did this experiment, I did this, and this yield strength increased from 49 to 58. Then we did wear resistance, and wear resistance improved from this to that. And then we did this, and it gives this much of efficiency. But finally, it is not clear to you whether what the person got is a good improvement, so-so improvement, or bad improvement. Okay. So there are markers that you can use to indicate. Of course, they have to be used carefully. If you write markers like 4,300 problem, it's a problematic problem, we have solved all that, so that becomes fluffy. But there are very restrained markers that you can use, but which still indicates the importance of what you are communicating. Again, I will show you a classic example of that. That is the tutorial that is coming up, where by using certain words and certain way of putting things across, you can make it clear to people as to what is the importance of what you are doing. And that is very, very important, and you should learn to do that, both in your presentations and in writing. Okay? Okay. So this is what I said. If you go look back at Raman and Krishnan's way of announcing how they have got the new type of radiation discovered, or Einstein's way of setting his hypothesis out, it follows all these kind of rules. They didn't put the rules and write. I am trying to make rules out of what people have written, which I think are good writing, and I am trying to find out what kind of rules will encompass all this. What I cannot put rules for is for the style and voice. But content and clarity I can put, and these are the rules that I am trying to fit in. So it is not necessary that this is always true, but you know the general principle, you know what to look for, so you should be able to make up your own mind on things. Okay. Now, in scientific writing, one thing that you don't do is just tell and not show. Okay. You can't say this is great. If you want to say that of all the existing materials, mine is better than everything else, put a plot, show where all the other materials are in that property, show where your material is. So that it should be clear. I don't have to make any claim. All that I'll write is, as is clear from figure so and so, with respect to this property, this is probably the best available material at this moment. Right? So you should always, if possible, replace text by figures, tables, and plots, whatever. Okay, each plot is worth thousands of words in terms of what they communicate, and the speed with which they communicate, and the impact with which they communicate. Okay, I can write one paragraph about how my material is great, but if on a plot I show all existing engineering materials and my material is like that on top, I don't need to make too much of noise, right? I can be very humble. I can say that look at the figure, it shows that our material is very good, and everybody understands what I mean by very good. And you have to be quantitative. People generally tend to write that this is a very common industrial process. Now, when they say very common industrial process, does that mean that, 95% of the industry uses it? 90%, 55%, 40%. 40% could be very common, because if all the other methods are only 5% and 10%, right? So you have to be quantitative. You have to give numbers. You can't make statements, right? Then you sound very fluffy if you don't do that. Now, when you give numbers, you should also be careful. You can't, you know, sometimes students put plot, they draw a line and they show a trend. But if you look at the error bars, those three numbers are not very different. Within the measurement error, they are the same numbers. So you have to put error bars, you should know the limitation of your numbers, you should not report anything beyond the accuracy to which it is calculated or measured. Okay. So giving quantitative information also means that you understand your statistics better. Okay. You know your data much more deeply, and then that should be communicated by putting all this information in. Now this is the point that we have also been discussing. You should know your audience. Okay. What you write in your annual progress seminar, which is meant for three professors to read, is different from your conference proceedings paper, which will be read by the community, which will be different from your journal paper, because it will be read by a much wider community. And it will be very different if you are writing an article for some newspaper or some local journal or something where you are trying to communicate the same information. This practice of trying to write the same information for different audience actually improves your writing skill a lot, because it keeps making you think, what is it that the audience know? In turn, it also questions, what is it that you know for sure? And if you have to go back to the origin of everything and start explaining from the basic, it's very easy to write a paper for your colleagues than to write something which your, say, parents or grandparents would understand. Because there is so much of background that I assume is available when I am writing for my colleagues. Only when I try to think in terms of communicating it with others, even somebody from some other department, then I will understand at a much deeper level. Okay? And in a much more communicable fashion. Okay? So you should always know your audience. Your stories change with audience. And deciding on the audience is also, that is why very important even in judging the writing. What is it meant for? For whom is it written for? Was it communicated by writing or through speech? All these questions become important. And sometimes by looking at the writing, you will have an inkling as to what it is for. I mean, somebody noticed the punctuation marks in Chandrasekhar's writing because, you know, it is spoken. So there is the pauses and stops and the gaps and... So you can, I mean, over a period of time, develop that kind of skill to even see something. And sometimes, I mean, when I'm reading, it's clear, oh, this must have been some address somewhere. And then there is a footnote which says, in such and such conference, this was the address which, based on which this article is written. So that skill, you can practice, you can get it by continuously paying attention to how things are being communicated. So these are some... simple things. If you are making any abbreviations, first time they should show up in expanded form. Equation should be neatly labeled. Every term should be explicitly explained. Figure should be clean. Axis should be labeled. Okay. Proper title should be given. If units are important, units are to be given. Somebody is going to read the data from that file sometime and going to use for their research. Any claim should be supported with references. And the way references should be written is to make it easy for somebody to go locate the paper or journal or book or the information. You know, please don't give reference to a book where in 232nd page, you know, one line is written. Right, in this page, page number 232, the last paragraph. Lots of young researchers will be very happy to read your papers if you do that. Okay. Some people do that. You know, they will give reference to a 500 page book. They will not tell you where. If I am from the area, I will know from where. But if I am starting research in the area, that kind of papers I don't really enjoy reading, because you know the person is not considerate to somebody new. Right? This is one way of keeping only the known people in the circle. It's keeping some people out. It should not be. Okay? You say page number 232, such and such. Similarly, when giving references, some people give the titles, which I like a lot, because the moment I see the title, I already make a decision about whether I want to take a look at this paper or not. Okay, so these are some good practices, again, scholarly practices. If you are a scientist in some lab, this doesn't matter. But I think as teachers, it matters a lot to us, because we are always concerned about how a new person in the area is going to work in the area. For that, these things are important. So please don't use informal words or expressions like okay, or don't or can't, that kind of spelling and informal spelling, you know, density and temperature and replaced by ampersand. And similarly, I mean, my advisor used to insist that 0 and 1 cannot be written in numerals in a flowing text. He will always ask me to write the 0 in words or unity instead of 1. Okay, so there are some stylistic things, but they vary from area to area and even within an area from some community to community. Those are community standards, which you will know if you see some several papers in that area. You will know what is a standard, but these are general. I mean, don't and can't is for almost everybody. Here is a reference, okay? And that reference has to be written in this format. Okay. Can you take 2 minutes to do this? Rather straightforward, there is no trick in this question, but it tells you how to read the reference. So, the most common error that people make in referencing is that they will give one reference like this, the second reference like this. And then sometimes they will say, there are three authors, they will write Aguilar et al. For everything. The general convention is 2 to 3 names, you write the full name, and only beyond that you put et al. And I actually personally don't like et al. At all. Okay. I am the fourth author in some paper and I am being left out simply because I am the fourth author. I don't like it, right? So write everybody's name. Okay. It's not difficult these days. And sometimes people do. Here they will write Jeffrey Ingram Taylor, and there they will just write Aguilar A. Wrong. And if you write G.I. Taylor with G dot, I dot, then A dot Aguilar, that is how it should be. Sometimes if you write just G space I space Taylor, then everywhere it should be the same format. In some it cannot be the first name and then the last name. Some it cannot be first initial, then the last initial. You can't flip the year. For example, there it is after the authors. Here it is in brackets. Right? Yes, sir.
The author's name, the first name first, then the
right.
G.I. Taylor, right. And in other paper they may give Taylor G.I.
Right.
And when I list it,
right.
Can I change that order?
You can change. As long as you are consistent, they will not crib. And there are software like LaTeX or BibTeX,
okay.
Which if you use, it is very easy to convert from one to the other.
No, is it correct to change the,
You should.
Okay.
In my opinion. Okay. Again, there are people who believe. This is where it becomes subjective. Some people believe that Taylor wants to be called G.I. Taylor. Who are you to say Taylor G.I.? Well, I am somebody who is reading, and so I decide how I will call. What Taylor wants to be called is his problem, not my problem. Okay. So, yes, you can change, in my opinion. And most of the journal editors will not have a problem as long as you are consistent within one style. They have a problem only, you know, first reference is G.I. Taylor, second reference is Aguilar A., then they have a problem. Right.
There are many formats like APA, Chicago or MLA.
Right.
Is it good to mention in a paper which style we are following?
No, ma'am.
Usually a journal asks for it.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't, suppose we are giving it in some other format.
No, it is not necessary. You can use whatever format that you think of and what is common in that area. Okay. Then it is mostly acceptable. But even if it is slightly off, people don't bother. Because even within a journal, you will see that some authors follow something. Like I always try to give all the titles of papers. Rarely the editor said that it is taking lots of space to remove it. If they do, then I have to do, of course, or you have to fight with the editor. That takes us to the afternoon's session where you have to write some tough emails to the editor as to why you don't want to remove the name without jeopardizing your publication. But that is a different issue. But most of the times, yes.
This much is the maximum number of words.
Yes.
Because when you write a full story,
right,
it is very difficult to put all the stuff
right.
into very a single paragraph.
Right.
And most of the abstracts which we see in IEEE papers, though they are very brief paragraphs.
That's right. So general rule is that abstract should not be more than 150 to 200 words. That is the kind of, so 150 to 200 words is like 5 lines. That is the kind of abstract which people will read fast, appreciate, decide what they want to do. Of course, I agree that it is extremely difficult to write such short abstracts. Okay, it's like that French writer who wrote, I apologize for this long letter because shorter one will take longer time for me to write. So it's always true. But you should put the effort and you should try to do it. There is going to be some sessions on elevator pitch and things like that. That is where Sundar's first day presentation was also. You should still be able to ask one single question and answer in one single sentence and one single line of background and one single line of impact. It is still possible, and some people, you know, do it very stylishly and very successfully. And not same people also are not always able to do it. I mean, I understand that it's subjective, it takes, sometimes you might get sometimes, but you should always put the effort. And it is almost always possible to get it. Okay.
Most of the time, the treatment of 100 questions are asking for only 150.
Yeah, 150 to 200. That is because research has shown that beyond that, for example, if you have 200 talks in a conference, nobody is going to read more than 5 sentences for any paper, however great it is. Okay, so.
Actually, there is a format in an university. Either we have to follow those formats, or as we are telling that.
Okay.
Reference and all, we can put as.
In my opinion, you should follow whichever format which is the best in your opinion. Now, sometimes, for example, thesis, people are very particular. If you don't put in that format, it will not go. But even there is lots of leeway. For example, thesis might say that the reference format is author, paper title, journal, volume, year. But they never tell you whether the author should be named this way or that way. That also, then you should follow only for their documents. Okay, reference is very specific. Okay, for example, in a 500 page, if I am using page 232, line 2, that is reference. It is bibliography if I say that just book without saying for what is it that I am referring to. Most of technical communication is based on references. If you are writing a monograph, of course, there is a bibliography. That is, I have also used these books to read and use the information here, but I haven't specifically claimed which information is from where. Reference is for claim. Suppose if I claim that solidification is the most important industrial process before engineering alloys can be used, I had better give a reference where it is explicitly stated that 90% of the materials before engineering use will undergo solidification. Suppose if I don't have that, but if I have 5 books on solidification which all talk about how it is important for engineering materials and several reviews, then I can list them as a bibliography. Okay? So reference is specific information, bibliography is generic information from that.
Yeah.
So footnote is mostly humanities. Most of the scientific ones, they want it as a reference.
Letter part, we are putting that bibliography in the.
That's right. So even when you give bibliography, sometimes yeah, you give specific references.
Because I read and everything you have to follow.
Right.
Related to that, the query of Anna University. Even I have received that the comments from a foreign examiner to my thesis. There are only two styles I know. One is APA and the other one is the MLA handbook. Okay, that's what is inclined to.
More common, but there are, see, there are as many referencing styles as there are people, and sometimes more than the number of people, because these are very, you know, like the internet flame wars. Everybody believes that this is the best way, and there is no logic to it.
Sir,
the paper I have submitted regarding last year, they have provided in different format.
Right.
And they have provided me.
Right. So what I am saying is stick to one format whenever you are writing something. If there is specific instruction that this is the format, stick to that format. If not, use one of the more common standard formats. But also use a tool to write your paper which allows you to change from one format to another format easily. LaTeX is that tool which will allow you to do that. Okay, so that is basically.
So, which style it will be, is it? The kind of question raised by the external examiner.
Right.
And then we have substantiated that it is the format which is completely developed and by the university. And then also, it is the combination of APA style and MLA style.
Right.
So, that's what we have substantiated and it's all approved.
So you can use it. I mean, that's
normally is that standard, like as you are telling that.
No, there is no standard. That's what I am telling. You see, even within physics journals, there is no single standard, okay? Because references cannot be standardized in any way. It all depends on what that particular journal says or what that particular authors feel, okay? But the general rules are In one document, there should be only one list of references. If it is reference, then it should be specific to information. Otherwise, it should be called bibliography. And if there is a norm as to what should be in that particular journal or conference proceeding or university, you should follow that. Otherwise, you are welcome to follow whatever you want to follow. Okay. Generally, there is enough leeway, except for strange cases like this, in terms of how to put your reference.
Sir, some of the journals, they write the short name, and some of the journals, like they write the full name. So, right. Which would be appropriate actually?
So, I generally prefer full name, because if I give short name, somebody has to go look up the list to know what the journal is. But sometimes journals insist on short name because they think that it is taking extra space. In which case, there is a standard abbreviation for the journals. That is what you should use. Okay, you should have that list with you. And the reader also will go through the same list and know which journal it is. Yes, sir. Right. Right. So that is why generally conference abstracts, your presentation doesn't have to be what you wrote in your abstract.
But sir, the man you have discussed in your writing order.
Right. Right.
You only can be checked up for it.
That's right.
You are going to promote the piracy in the business or
not? It will promote what?
Yeah, piracy.
Piracy? What is that? Plagiarism. No, just because somebody is asking for details does not mean that you have to plagiarize. How are they connected? I don't understand. See, I don't have the full picture. So, I am going to write that this is a problem that I am planning to explore. If they are not happy, they can reject my abstract. But just because for them to accept my abstract, I am not going to plagiarize something and put it there.
Very clearly, you don't have the complete, you know, general or the article, but
you are billing to some idea. Right. You only can send us an abstract. Right. Yeah, just submit the abstract. And if they insist, don't go for that conference. I mean, we are interested in science, not to...
Hello.
Right. Hey, yes.
I had a quick question.
Yeah.
This last reference, the G.I. Taylor.
Right.
Is that an accepted form of citing? Yeah. Because there's no comma between G.I. Taylor and the Institute of Metals.
Yeah.
So we don't really know where the guy's name ends and where the journal begins. But that is an accepted
sometimes form. Sometimes it is. Okay. Sometimes it is. But in general, there will be a comma.
Because in the one on top, there is a comma.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe because it's very old, it's 1938 or?
Yeah, and most of the times so J starts, so that must be the journal. So, but there can be confusion. So, there are also, see for example, in the first reference also, there are people who believe that Aguilar, Binosi, and after that there should be a comma before you start the next writer. Okay, it's called Oxford comma or something. Okay. So, yes, so some old times you will see things like this. In those days there were hardly 5-6 references, but nowadays it is, you know, it's better to put more punctuation marks than to